can't hit that song today.
They can't do it today?
No, the horse.
Myself. Now, I need you to go blow your nose, get focused, and they did just that.
The children of the world, reach out.
I sent a videotape to New York and said, oh, you got to see these girls.
They kept saying, we're very interested, we're very interested.
They were almost signed, but it didn't happen.
By then, I'm thinking, man, they're really just giving me the runaround, so I started looking at other opportunities.
I had a production company called Silent Partner. We were always looking for new talent, so I went to Texas, and they sang for me.
Can it be I stayed away too long? Did I lose your mind when I was gone?
Every great group has a person that drives it. You know, the Jackson 5 had Michael. That day, it was like, okay, she's the one.
I want to be where you are.
Beyonce got right in my face, and she sang, and she moved her head. It was like, whoa, I think this kid has got it.
We ended up signing a production deal with Daryl Simmons.
I brought them to Atlanta to work on getting a record deal. We were rehearsing, recording a little bit. So they were there for 2.5, 3 years. They worked hard. But nothing happened. The feedback that I was getting was, they look too sexy. They look too mature. This is during a time when it was baggy pants and hat to the back. So we kept pursuing and kept pursuing, and comes the Elektra situation. I meet with Elektra. I said, I got this group, and I think, you know, there's a girl in the group. I think she's definitely a star, and I'd like for you to see him. So we do the ultimate showcase. They sign the girls. Everybody's happy. Finally, everything is happening.
Beyonce was ecstatic.
It's like, wow, my dream is finally coming true, and all this hard work and sacrifice is about to pay off.
It wasn't long before things got weird. Elektra, they weren't feeling me.
The process was going somewhat slow.
We actually didn't even put together an album. That's how on the shelf we were.
I kind of really didn't know what I was doing.
Daryl did everything he could, but the timing wasn't right, and it just didn't work.
I was dropped from Elektra, and in turn, anything that was attached with to me was also dropped.
Definitely a low point for Beyonce and the rest of the girls. Here you have some kids that have been trying since age 9, and when you just when you think you have it, and then you're thrown that curve again, it's like, it's very disappointing.
Next, Beyonce's parents make the ultimate sacrifice.
The only way that I could really be successful at this was really dedicate all of Matthew to it, and that meant leaving corporate America.
Nothing worth anything comes without a cost.
Our marriage really suffered then.
Then, Beyonce hits rock bottom.
I would speak to Tina, and Tina's like, she wouldn't get out of bed today, Janella.
It was like the world was caving in on her. I don't think I've ever seen her that depressed.
When they got dropped from Elektra, I remember how heartbreaking it was for Beyonce to have to come back to Houston.
It seemed like every setback that the group experienced, it affected their family in some type of way.
He and Tina both put everything they had into Girls Time, money, time, their house.
You know, it's admirable when parents believe enough in their children's dreams, be willing to step out there. But nothing worth anything comes without a cost.
The only way that I could really be successful at this was really dedicate all of Matthew to it, and that meant leaving corporate America.
It was a huge adjustment because you're going from making this huge income, and now you've quit your job.
Matthew still had that mentality that he was making six figures, and he was spending $5,000 on packages and photo shoots and Kinko bills, and I was like, you know, things have changed now.
Tina had to take care of everything, so she worked and she ran her salon, and the family survived off of what Tina was making.
We had a lot of turmoil about that.
Our marriage really suffered then.
We had to sell our house. We started selling the cars.
At that point, my mother and father had separated.
I just took the girls one day and moved them into an apartment.
We went from living in a 6-bedroom house with this beautiful living space, and we had to move into a 2-bedroom apartment.
And there were a lot of us that were kind of sitting and watching on the sidelines thinking, you know, maybe, you know, he really ought to go back and do something else. And he just kept moving forward.
Matthew doesn't acknowledge failure, so he doesn't let anyone around him do that either. So he got the girls right up and going again.
My first call, obviously, was back to Columbia.
Matthew called me and said, "Are you still interested?" And I was like, "Absolutely, are you kidding?" The girls were flown up to showcase for all of the department heads.
I remember being very nervous and the rest of the girls being nervous, and Beyonce was just so strong. She was just like, "We're gonna go and we're gonna nail this." She was determined, so it was like, okay, we have something to prove now.
Columbia actually got a chance to see them perform in a room with all the big cats and the small cats and just everything. Right on point, they blew them away.
Columbia signs us, and we all cried and we couldn't believe it.
They were like, "We got a deal, we got a deal, we got it, we got." I mean, they were ecstatic.
My mother and father got back together. We moved into another house.
And that was like, oh God, it was such a blessing.
When we signed at Columbia, we were searching for names.
And I came across the Bible and just opened it up, and I saw Destiny.
And I came up with Child, Destiny's Child. We started working on the album.
They were young, focused like grown-ups in the room, and it would trip you out. You get intimidated by these youngsters.
We just really, really wanted it this time, and we were willing to do, you know, whatever it took, hard work, we were there.
I knew they were hot, and I knew with or without me, they were gonna be the shit. I recognize this is gonna be a super group.
They decided that No 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 would be the first single, and I remember them going ahead and doing a remix for it before the album came out, and that's when they met Wyclef.
This is the remix. Radio's played it.
As a producer, you always want to be part of what you think is going to be the next hottest thing.
They needed someone to help push them out there.
I knew I could cook up something for them because I felt like it was going to be some, you know, real big, big stuff.
They went into the studio one morning, and it took literally 57 minutes to record from start to finish. No, 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 Part 2. I know you want me, I can see it in your eyes.
But you keep on fighting with yourselves on your mind. The first time Beyonce ever heard it on the radio, she was picking me up from school. And I remember her pulling up and yelling, "Solange, Solange, come to the car." I'm like, "That's us, that's us, oh my God, that's us." And I'm like, "Ah, we're on the radio, we're on the radio." And we get in the car, we turn it up, we turn the windows down, and we just like, "Yeah, yeah." She's like, "That's me." And I'm like, "That's you, that's you." Once that song hit, it was something different, it was something fresh, and it just blew up.
No, No, No ended up the number one single, number one airplay.
Matthew's vision was to hurry up and put something else out and ride off the wave of the single.
We got ready to make the second record for Destiny's Child, The Writing's on the Wall.
At that point, Beyonce was really emerging as a songwriter.
You know, you can't just sit on that. It was time for her in particular to get those juices going, start writing.
So she ended up writing quite a bit on the second album and producing.
She had slashes in her name now, you know. A singer, songwriter, producer, like, woo!
The first single for Writings on the Walls was Bills, Bills, Bills.
From that point, I could see the press returning my calls a little sooner, a little more enthusiasm. I'm calling about Destiny's Child as opposed to, I got that package on that group.
Business was beginning to really heat up.
These girls work their tails off.
What's up, what's up, what's up? We're Destiny's Child.
We're Destiny's Child.
We're Destiny's Child.
Destiny's Child.
Destiny's Child.
Destiny's Child.
I could not perform enough.
Let me hear you say, why you flirting when you know you really want it?
They could not do enough promotion.
Hey, how you doing? Yeah, I'm doing mighty fine.
I mean, they couldn't work hard enough.
Bills, Bills, Bills turns into a number one song on the Billboard charts, and we're really selling records, and things are going great.
You become this public property to the world when you have a hit. You know, you got all these people. Who knows what could happen?
Beyonce got a lot of slack for my dad being their manager. They would say that he's treating her differently because she's his daughter.
Two of the ladies decided they weren't happy with me managing the group, and they wanted me to step down, saying that you were going to fire the manager without the team agreeing to that was not a good thing.
Beyonce was incredibly hurt by it, called the girls, tried to say to them, you know, can't we work this out? Please don't do this.
When Latavia and Latoya left the group, it was a very emotional process. These girls had known each other for a long time. They'd all overcome very difficult hurdles.
And they sacrificed a whole lot to get this group, Destiny's Child, off the ground. I would never have left a group of that magnitude.
Beyonce was not devastated because they left the group. She was devastated on a personal level.
It was the first time I really saw her sort of just go into a shell. You know, for everyone, it was a group. For her, it was a friendship.
They were brought up as sisters. That's years and years of friendship and loving somebody to just all of a sudden just stop.
She was very sad.
I would speak to Tina, and Tina's like, she wouldn't even get out of bed today, Janella.
It was like the world was caving in on her. I don't think I've ever seen her that depressed.
Next, the press has a feeding frenzy.
Was it all over the papers? It was every time you turned on the television. And, you know, she was being presented as this blood-sucking diva.
I remember having a conversation with her, and she was so distraught.
And later, Beyonce gets her revenge.
For years, she would let things that she would read or people would say get to her. She just was kind of fed up with it.
There was this DJ that made up a joke about us, you know, who's going to be the last Destiny's Child member on the island. And she was like, oh, you want to make jokes? I'm a survivor.
I'm a survivor.
Log on to VH1.com to see rare photos and footage of Beyonce. And check out early photos and footage of all Driven.
And the lineup for Destiny's Child changed, and the two members decided to exit. Beyonce spent a lot of time in prayer trying to figure out what they were going to do.
Was it going to be Kelly and Beyonce? You know, was that going to be the right balance? You know, Destiny's Child was now two girls, or what?
They interviewed some singers.
The girls had gotten to know Farrah. Farrah was an extra in a music video. She was a pretty girl, so Farrah joined the group.
So they was like, do you know anybody else? And I'm like, I know this one girl.
Michelle was a great singer, so it was like immediate. It was like, you have to give us an answer now, and you have to come to Houston now.
It was kind of like a phone call today, and tomorrow you got to get on the plane because we got to shoot Say My Name.
Say my name, say my name, say my name is around you. Baby, I love you.
Say My Name was the first video with the two new members.
It was so nerve-wracking because, okay, this is the new Destiny's Child, you know, like, okay.